order of service for today is in the service folder that was handed to you as you came into the church this morning. The first thing that we're going to do is sing a hymn there. I know that my Redeemer lives. You can see the hymn numbers there. It's the kind of brownish purple hymnal in front of you. And then we'll follow it. The things in darker are for you, and the other lighter colored things are for me. Spirit. Amen. In holy baptism, Kathleen was clothed with the robe of Christ's righteousness that covered her sin. St. Paul says, "Do you not know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried there with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we were united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise. Come and see what God has done. He is awesome in his deeds toward the children of man. Come and hear, all you who fear God, and I will tell you what he has done for my soul. I cried to him with my mouth, and high praise was on my tongue. If I had cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. Blessed be God, because he has not rejected my prayer or removed his steadfast love from me. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy. mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. The Lord be with you. O God of grace and mercy, we give thanks for your loving kindness shown to Kathleen and to all your servants who, having finished their course in faith, now rest from their labors. Grant that we also may be faithful unto death and receive the crown of eternal life through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Old Testament lesson for this day, Job chapter 19. Oh, that my words were written. Oh, that they were inscribed in a book. Oh, that with an iron pen and lead they were engraved in the rock forever. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and at the last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been thus destroyed, yet in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself. And my eyes shall behold, and not another. My heart faints within me. This is the word of the Lord. These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, and whose heart are the highways to Zion. Second reading from Revelation chapter 2. This is a section of scripture that was selected by Kay. And to the angel of the church in Smyrna write, the words of the first and the last who died and came to life. I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that they may be tested, and for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise for the gospel. Alleluia, alleluia. Jesus Christ is the firstborn of the dead. To him be glory and power forever. Alleluia, alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 25th chapter. Glory to you, O Christ. Jesus said, then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. For when the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. But the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a cry, here is the bridegroom, come out to meet him. Then all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise answered, saying, since there will not be for us and for you, go rather to the dealers and buy for yourselves. And while they were going to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready to go in went with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered, truly I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for the hymn. Thank you. For each of you, the peace and joy which comes only from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, because he is the one who was, who is, and who is yet to come. The text is from the gospel that I just read to you a few moments ago. I'd like to just read these words again. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour. For the first 3 years or so after DeWitt died, Kay and I had regular visits, good conversations. It was especially good for me as her pastor because she was always eager to receive the sacrament of her Lord's holy body and blood. The next couple of years were kind of hit or miss, and the last year had been very difficult because of her deteriorating physical condition. Clearly death was approaching, but just like it always does, we get the announcement and death always catches us by surprise. And so that means that every death raises questions, and some questioning, well, it's always good. Surely it's Christ's hope that every funeral would be a time for meditation and for having the important questions answered. In his 14th chapter, Job asks this question: if a man shall die, will he live again? That's one of the questions that comes to mind at every funeral. Are human beings more than animals? Is there a place for us after death? Or is death the end for both man and beast? Now, during Christ's earthly life, there were certain groups in the church who completely denied there was any possibility of resurrection from the dead. And in fact, no major religion in the world teaches a resurrection from the dead except for Christianity. In fact, there are many people out there, maybe you know some of them, who believe that the spirits of the dead, well, they just run around loose somewhere in the cosmos. And certainly a poll of public opinion that would poll what people think about what happens after death would reveal a tremendous amount of confusion and contradiction. So, if a person dies, will they live again? Thank God that in Christ Jesus you don't have to guess. Don't have to base your answer on opinion polls. The Bible, God's pure and inerrant word, gives the answer, which is clear, and it gives great comfort to those who believe. The Lord and Savior Christ Jesus, the one who died and who rose again for Kay and for everyone else, that Jesus promises in John 5, the hour is coming when all in their graves will hear my voice and will come out. The Apostle Paul was inspired by the Holy Spirit to write this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. When the last trumpet sounds, yes, it will sound, and the dead will be raised at the right time, at the time appointed by God. The Bible says Christ is going to come in all his glory, with all of his holy angels with him, and then all the people of every nation from all of time will be gathered before him, and Scripture says he will separate the sheep from the goats. Now, the sheep in the scriptures are described as those who believe in and who follow Christ. They, the Bible says, will be given everlasting life. The goats are those described there as unbelievers who will go away into everlasting punishment. So according to God's word, all who die will rise from the dead. And God's word says they will live in one of two places. They will live both, or they will live either in everlasting life with Christ or in unending condemnation. But here is our comfort through faith in Christ Jesus. John chapter 3. God loved the world so much he gave his only Son that everyone who believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world would be saved through him. So, once a person dies, can he live again? Yes. In heaven or in hell? And that's why Christ pleads, therefore, keep awake, because you do not know the day or the hour. I've had funerals where the mourner, one or two, will ask me, did my loved one go to heaven? It's very logical, but it's kind of a belated question. Because you see, at the funeral, it's too late to have such concern. And the fact is, it's the wrong question. You see, no one goes to heaven. that would imply that being there is in some way under your control, that you do something in order to get there. But Christians know that we aren't saved by the good things we do and the evil things that we avoid in life. We're saved by faith in the Christ who paid for our sin by his death. Romans chapter 10 tells us that faith comes by hearing the word of God. I heard Kay confess she'd heard the message of Christ. And by the gift of faith, by God's grace, she believed and trusted Christ. So you see, Kay didn't go to heaven. She was brought there by her Lord and Savior, Christ Jesus. Kay knew that she wasn't perfect, not even close. In fact, she was just like all the rest of us here. She was a sinner. But God had shown to her heart that Christ forgave her her sin and that everlasting life was hers by a gift of faith in him. So you see, the question that Kay would want all of you to deal with today has nothing to do with why a person dies, when we may think that maybe it's too soon or it's too sudden, or why it wasn't someone else, someone that we didn't know personally, somebody that we didn't know and love. He would want you to ask yourself, am I ready for my own death? Every funeral should teach you that you don't know how many more days yours will be. That we all die, and that we don't know the day in advance. And that should emphasize for us that being ready isn't best to be left for next year or next month or next week or even tomorrow. During my 36 years as a pastor, all the funerals that I've conducted, they've been for members who've died from heart attacks or in some other sudden and unexpected manner. My own father was stricken at a church meeting by an aneurysm and died right there at church. He died suddenly and unexpectedly. You probably know people who've died with very little warning. So Christ tells you to be ready for the day, and that's no idle statement. That's why Christ paves the way eternal life. If you were to die today, or if Christ were to arrive right now and usher in earth's final moment, are you ready? The door is open through faith in Christ. You see, just having your name on some church roll somewhere or making certain that they get a preacher to preach over you when you die or even a relative's heartfelt desire, none of that can open heaven for you. Each must have his or her own faith in Christ. That's why the Savior pleads, keep awake, because you do not know the day or the hour. Now, I've been telling you for the last few minutes that you should be ready for eternity, but you may be confused about what that involves. How do you make ready for the coming of Christ and for everlasting life? Well, God's word says readiness begins with a recognition of your sinful and lost condition. Now, let's face the fact that some of us here aren't ready, and that we will remain unready so long as we find a way to self-justify our lives and our conduct. Maybe with some soft thoughts similar to these. I'm just as good as most church members. I'm better than the majority of the people that I read about in the newspaper or hear about on the news. I do everything that could be expected of me under the circumstances. And you know, for argument's sake, I'll even allow that each one of you might be better than every other person in the world. But it doesn't make any difference, because it isn't enough. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, there is not a just man upon the earth who always does good and never sins. And with that reminder from God's word that we all sin, Romans chapter 6 tells us the wages of sin, any sin, is death. You see, heaven's perfect, just as the God who lives there is perfect. By definition, he cannot corrupt perfection with the imperfection of sinful human beings. So if you think you're ready on your own goodness, you're sadly mistaken. 1 John says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. So though you or me or any of us may be good or better than every other human being on earth, it's not enough. Proverbs 28 says, he that covers his sins shall not prosper. God's mercy is given to those who no longer defend themselves in their conduct, but who instead believe in the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Readiness for eternal life is in believing Christ is your Savior from sin. And the only reason you can believe and be ready is because Christ Jesus makes you ready. He does it by enabling you to trust by the Holy Spirit working through the word about Christ, to trust only in what he did for you on that cross. God's Spirit creates faith in the heart. Faith that believes that Christ died to pay for our sin and to cleanse us from all that sin. That is why Christ was punished in our place, so that we could be healed. And that Christ has now ascended into heaven. After rising from the dead, he went there to prepare a place for all of those who believe. That place is a perfect paradise, lasting forever. By faith given, we know our Savior is Christ Jesus, that having taken all our sin into his own body, he paid for it by removing it, the corrupting stain is taken from us, completely from us, and by his rising from the dead, we know that the Heavenly Father accepted that sacrifice as a payment for our sin. Jesus said, whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Oh, our body's going to give out, just like Kay's did, but that which is truly Kay, her spirit, still lives and is right now enjoying the fruits of heaven. Christ has promised he'll rejoin her body and her spirit on the last day, and that's why Christians confess, thank God he gives us the victory through faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, securing our forgiveness and life with his blood. But what do you need to do to be ready? The answer of God's word is absolutely nothing. Christ has done it all for you. Listen to 2 Timothy. God saved us and called us to be holy, not because we did anything, but because he planned a gift of his grace and gave it to us in Christ Jesus. Romans 15, the God of hope fills you with perfect happiness and peace, and he makes you overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. That's what Kay believed. It was her confession each time we got together. She confessed it when she received Christ's holy body and blood. God gave Kay the faith that saved her. So, once a person dies, will they live again? If Kay were here right now, she would tell you, yes. But you see, she can't. Because through the readiness of faith, she's enjoying everlasting life in heaven right now. But you can be ready as Kay was, and at God's right time, join her there in heaven. Remember and believe in God's forgiveness and the mercy shown to us in the word about Christ. Because our guarantee is through faith in Jesus' precious name. Please rise for prayer. Let us pray to the Lord, our God and Father, who raised Jesus from the dead. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together into one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and so pass with him through the gate of death and the grave to our joyful resurrection. Lord, in your mercy, grant that all who have been nourished by the holy body and blood of your Son may be raised to immortality and incorruption to be seated with him at your heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy, give to the family of Kathleen and to all who mourn comfort in their grief and assured confidence in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Lord, in your mercy, give courage and faith to the bereaved, that within the communion of your church, they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the assurance of a holy and certain hope and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love that have departed in the faith. Lord, in your mercy, Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and find comfort in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy, receive our thanks for Kathleen and for all the blessings you bestowed on her in this earthly life. Bring us at last to our heavenly home, that with her we may see you face to face in the joys of paradise. Lord, in your mercy. O God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light. We give you thanks that by his death he has destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Strengthen us in the confidence that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death, nor life, nor things present, nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Taught by our Lord and trusting his promises, we are bold to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Lord, now you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations, and the glory of your people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. The Lord be with you. Lord God, our shepherd, you gather the lambs of your flock into the arms of your mercy, and you bring them home. Comfort us with the certain hope of the resurrection to everlasting life, and a joyful reunion with those we love who have died in the faith. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. Please be seated. We'll sing the final hymn. Falls the eventide, the We're going to have a little lunch that's been prepared by the family. If you'll just go straight out of the nave here and take a left as you go down that hall straight ahead and to the left, that's where we'll have the lunch. And I hope you can stay and talk with the family and enjoy some remembrances and other things together. And stay as long as you like. We're really glad to have you here today.